Hey everybody, welcome to VO Buzz Weekly.
Thanks for coming back for part two with Ben Patrick Johnson. Promo voice, movie trailer voice, oh my gosh, here we go.
Turn it up.
Get ready.
You're tuned in to VO Buzz Weekly. And now, prepare to get seriously buzzed with your hosts, Chuck Duran and Stacey J. Aswan.
Welcome back to VO Buzz Weekly. I'm Ben, your host. This is my dog, Chelsea. I don't know who these people are.
We don't know who him
we're
he is.
We're from the animal rescue that brought you.
That's
Chelsea.
Right.
Okay, so we're back from a quick break. But
only
hey, Ben,
rescue
let's
animals.
Talk about fiber.
Yes, sir.
No, seriously, man. What's
gardening
your,
tips.
What's your workout routine?
My workout routine is really varies. I can get away with, because I've done it for so many years, I can just go like 6 months and do almost nothing. Mm. Don't tell anyone that.
Yeah.
But for the most part, I do cardio in the morning. I eat a number of small meals
during
the
day. Like what's cardio? Like what do? Do you jog?
I jump on some contraption that looks like it's going to rip your arms off.
Okay.
And so either treadmill or the elliptical machine or somewhere you kind of go like this or this.
Yeah. There's a lot of multitasking going on.
Yeah.
Yes, very good.
The good part is you can also manipulate your little phone and stuff and talk to your grandmother.
Cardio in the morning.
Cardio in the morning, eat little meals in the day.
How many meals do you eat a day?
732. Now I try to eat like 5 or 6.
Okay.
Yeah,
and none of them too big, none too small.
Just right.
And then I don't know what voice we're doing, but
we're
doing the same one.
Yeah, it's a good one.
We
can mark it. You guys are like twins.
Stacey and I will be doing this voice. This is from some country. We're like a mix of Indian and Eastern European.
Something like that.
I think I must have had some of your old workout drink. I'm Mrs. Hyde now.
Cheers.
Go see.
I'm very excited.
And then you work out again in the afternoon?
In the afternoon, you go to the gym and you lift. But not for that long. Here's the thing. Don't fall into the trap of believing that you've got to spend like 3 hours a day in the gym. It's a bunch of malarkey. 45 minutes is so way more than adequate.
Yeah.
Really. Especially if you're going like 4 or 5 days a week. I mean, come on. Go spend half an hour at the gym and then
And then dinner, a few more snacks, and then do you work out again at night?
No.
Okay.
That would be too much.
He's not a robot.
You got to draw the line somewhere.
Dude, you're freaking nuts. I'm tired.
No, I am freaking nuts, but no. No, I could have been, and I don't, I could have been, people say like, oh, you exercise a lot and then you have energy. That's such bull. You work out and you're tired. That's how it works. Come on, I live here on the real world, planet Earth. You work out and then you're tired. So I'm in like right now, I mean, it's, it's a certain hour here in Los
winding
Angeles. It's winding down time. People.
What time do you go to bed?
I'm embarrassed, like 9:30.
9:30?
Oh my gosh, we got to talk fast then.
Wow.
Sure.
But I get up so.
Oh shit.
You get up early.
We got to get you out of here.
You've got East Coast stuff to do, so you're up early.
Sure, and I also like to, I get, especially early in the day, I multitask so poorly that any interruption, I'm just like, ah! So, I have to get all my stuff done before anyone can remotely call me or ask me to do anything.
Yeah.
You know, the East Coast stuff does start to trickle in, especially because there are people in the East Coast, and I don't understand this, they go in early. And so then that's like 3 o'clock our time, and they're going, that's just wrong. That's 3 in the morning.
Yeah.
So, there are the emails that come at 4:35 in the morning. Yep. Hey, we need these lines picked up.
And you're jumping on them right away.
You know, okay.
That's cool.
Go ahead.
Can we talk about your home studio, man?
Yes, sir.
What do you have in there? What do you use?
It used to be like, I'm looking, you've got a big old setup over here. It used to be very elaborate, and it's gotten smaller and less and less. Just a Macintosh computer, basic two-track audio mastering software, a microphone, and a basic board.
Any specific software that you use?
I use Twisted Wave.
Okay,
simple stuff.
A lot of people use that,
Love it.
What kind of microphone do you use?
I use a Sennheiser 416.
Okay. Preamp?
You know what? I see you use the Avalon, which I love. It's warm, it's beautiful, it's gorgeous.
Yep.
It's thousands. So I sold mine. I just thought, do I really need this? Is this really what is essential for me? And I'm just plugging it into the preamp of the mixer at this point.
Okay.
I know it sounds...
Just
for the... You got to think about the fact that it's not like we're recording orchestral music, but open and lots of airy with overtones. It's just voiceovers that are being compressed, turned into, we used to use ISDN, that's almost gone now.
Yeah.
But it's being compressed down into MP3 or AAC, sent through a line, then mixed, resampled, compressed all to hell again.
Exactly.
Sent out to do the broadcast chain work, it's processed.
So you're trying to process as least as possible.
Yeah.
Well, as little as possible, but also it's basically chewed up into, you know, granola bits by the time it actually comes out someone's speaker at home. What you do to it early on, yes, it does have an effect, but only so much.
Exactly.
It's really about just getting the sound from point A to point B.
You sort of have your own built-in preamp.
Kind of.
You have like a genetic preamp.
Well, no, he doesn't, but what mixer do you use that you use the
preamp? I use a Mackie 1406.
Okay, very, very clean preamp. It's a really nice preamp.
XDR
That's cool.
preamp.
But here's the thing, man. Your voice has so much attack and presence already on it that if you used the Avalon, like, it would be too much. Because you're like a preamp. You're like, you got like a built-in preamp, man.
Yeah.
Can I? I'm going to use that.
Yeah. Like
that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
True
or
false?
He has
a built-in preamp.
True or false? Is, Stacey told me that she read something somewhere.
That's
that
why it's
studio,
true or false. Is it solar powered?
It is.
It is?
Yes. I have, well, first of all, I had a very nice.
Let's say that again. His studio is solar powered.
It's solar powered. There are panels on the roof, which, there's not enough sunshine in California to power my whole house. Either that or I'm an energy hog. But there's plenty enough to power the studio and a few other things. So it's all,
brilliant.
It goes into these big car batteries, which are down under the house. It sounds made up, and I'm not making this up. It's true. and there's like a coffin-sized thing of car batteries and all cables sent to them all up. And so the sun comes up in the sky from Jesus and God, and it goes in the roof, and then the electricity goes down under the house, and then it comes up, and then I talk, and the voice goes out.
That's awesome.
Well, absolutely. Dude,
that's
put it right
so
here.
Fun.
That is the coolest thing
I
have ever heard on the planet.
I love that.
You hear that, Paz? Solar powered.
Of course, when it's cloudy out, you know.
Oopsie.
I'm silent. You can't hear anything.
You're like, I have one take and I have enough power for one take.
That's it.
Do
I'm
you
done.
Have a backup plan?
Yeah, do you
have
a backup plan?
No?
I've found in life.
Good.
A backup plan breeds laziness, you know.
That is so awesome.
And that breeds contempt, so there you go.
So people probably ask you this
yes,
all
sir.
The time.
Yes. I try to respect authority.
Listen,
so I call everyone sir when they speak to me.
I've been told I have, you know, balls.
Well, I'm not.
You've been asked.
He's looking. He's like,
I own it.
Yeah, no.
I own it. We don't say I'm bossy. I'm confident.
Right. Yeah, she's very confident.
So people must ask you all the time, mm-hmm. how do I get into voiceover?
Mm-hmm. The answer
how do
is,
you answer them?
Probably not the way. People believe that you go knock on an agent's door and say, hi, I'd like to do a voice. No. You sit in your living room. You have your DVR. DVR now, you know, stuff is coming more internet.
Right.
You listen to commercials and listen to promos over and over and over again. You are afraid, as you are doing this, that if you imitate what you hear, you're just going to become an imitation, and you're wrong. Because you are so strikingly you and unlike anyone else, that it's going to be you regardless. But there is a certain paradigm to which one must conform. And there is, it's a sandbox that has a certain size that you get to play in.
Yeah.
And there are certain ways in which we play in this sandbox.
Yeah.
Each of us as a very distinct individual. So you listen and listen and listen, imitate, transcribe the spots that you hear, things that sound remotely like your vocal range. You play around, and then maybe at some point you take a class at a local community college, or if you're lucky enough to be in Los Angeles, New York, Atlanta, Chicago, San Francisco, a few other places like that, Greensville, can do a class with working professionals. And from there, once you've done a group class, you can specialize down more into coaching.
Private coaching.
And at the end of all of that, not the end, but in the as you get through some of that, then is when you're going to have a demo that you're going to approach agents with.
Exactly.
Not at the beginning, a good stretch into it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because you have to be able to work competitively and audition against people that are at full speed, that are doing this every day.
Yeah.
Whether they're brilliant or not, they're
mm-hmm.
doing this, they're waking up and doing this and all day long going to bed. So you have to have that degree of comfort, smoothness, proficiency.
Yeah.
And the only way to learn to play the violin is to play the violin.
Yeah.
So you have to do it to get it to do it. And the good part is you can do it at home.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Did you do that when
I
you
did.
Were first starting out?
I absolutely
did.
Doing? I had a cassette tape recorder and I would read the damn newspaper.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cool. And then did you imitate
yes.
other guys
yes,
out there?
Yes, I did.
Can you say what are some of the guys?
Well, Don LaFontaine, mm-hmm. for gosh sakes. His voice more than anyone else, probably Dick Irvesty,
okay.
who I've not spoken about previously in this interview. Ernie Anderson.
Yeah.
These are the lions of the
exactly.
industry.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so knowing what you know now.
Yes, sir. See, I called you sir. Oh my God.
I kind of like it. I kind of like it. That's our thing.
I mean, you could be like wearing taffeta.
Just don't call her ma'am.
No, I'm not.
You meant sirster.
Never.
I kind of like it. Don't apologize. Okay. It's kind of working for. It's working for us.
All right, sir.
Okay. So knowing what you know, ma'am.
Yes.
Knowing what you know now, mm-hmm. would you have done anything differently in your career?
Ooh. Well, yes, not done drugs. Mm-hmm. But that's not really in my career. That's a great question. I've never been asked that. Not stress so much. Mm. Understand that A, things are cyclical. B, you'll work. C, relax. I mean, you know, mm-hmm. I get so wound up and anxious about things that I do. In all aspects of life, but certainly professionally.
Yeah.
And that does not bring out the best performances of our lives.
Yeah.
You know, it's...
Yeah.
Although, ironically, a flip to that is the fact that sometimes it's when we are the most guarded and protected that we also don't do our best performances. We need to be in this sort of slightly off-balance thing. Present, but not completely poised and protected, and that's when the emotional...
When you're attached to the expectation, it just sort of paralyzes you.
Here on the Oprah Network.
Yes.
Yes.
Could you cry a little? It would really help the ratings.
Pinch me, sister.
No, I like
that. They brought me a whole roll of toilet in plastic wrapping. And, like, handed it to me. Like, I'm supposed to, fruit.
First.
I'm not quite sure. But
Has there ever been a time in your career where you got a piece of advice from somebody that just, like, bam, like, just really, really helped out a lot?
I was told once in an acting class, and I don't think this was original, but every villain is the hero of his own movie. When we're talking about someone, if we're selling something, because there's always conflict when we're telling a story. And the best stories are the complex ones. And when you can present through just the subtlest of shading that you believe that the villain isn't completely bad, but is complex. It makes you more interesting. It makes the programmer film more interesting for the viewer. Mm-hmm. And in a way that is almost indescribable, it pulls people.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, finding the humanity of that.
That's cool.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Even when you're talking about, and you know, we use these hackneyed phrases, a ruthless killer on the loose. I mean, we do say things like this, you know, LA's latest serial killer. But even as we're sort of painting with this garish brush, to remember that the characters we're talking about are human. And I think if there's one thing that I think I've talked about throughout the course of our conversation here, it's about the authenticity, about the humanity, the realness, the presence of it all.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not about, and I think it is so easy to copy the artifice of a voiceover and then the, you know, the trail of the voice at the end of the phrase and that kind of thing. But that's really not where it's at. It's not about having the beautiful voice or this or that. It's about being present.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That's cool, man.
Absolutely. Can we talk about your beautiful books and your foundation?
Sure.
I love so much about you.
Thank you.
And respect so much about you, but
you.
I love your desire and your actual, well, more than desire, you actually follow through and give back. And I love that to all different communities and all different humans. So tell us about some of the other stuff you have going on.
Well, we talk about giving back to humans. I think what is at the basis of all that is good in the world is empathy. And we see in others what we know in ourself, and thereby vibrate at their same frequency. We become, a part of us becomes one with them, and that is what is right and good. Now, it's a constant exercise that requires work. You can't stay clean today from yesterday's shower. Likewise, it is easy to advocate on behalf of one's own group, people who worship like you do, who have the same racial background, who love like right. you do, who have the same value set. It's much more challenging and much more ultimately rewarding for all parties involved when we advocate on behalf of people who do not look like us, who do not love like us, who do have other choices. So early on, it's become quite in vogue now to advocate on behalf of transgender folks, and let's mm-hmm. put them on, you know, let's put on magazine covers and this and that and rah rah rah, and it's the latest sort of liberal thing. But long before that, these people were pariahs, and they, to a large extent, and in the larger society, they still are. But who's going to stand up for that? Who's going to stand up for post 9/11 Muslim Americans? Mm-hmm. Who's going to stand up for people that you know, the latest wave of again, whatever the delineation, the classification is, mm-hmm. people that are being oppressed, and we benefit hugely as human beings from being of service, period, but especially being of service where it causes us to stretch and gives us just a bit of discomfort. Mm-hmm. That is how we grow.
Yeah.
And that is ultimately how we, I think, find life satisfaction and happiness. Everyone has their own set of things that make them happy, but I think if we have one thing that we share as human beings, it is the remarkable feeling of being on either the giving or the receiving end of empathy. It is what is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's a great equalizer.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And so externally, I try to operate with that in mind. And so I have it's just a very, very small foundation,
yeah.
Which is largely just a tax pass through for my own giving. But it would be easy for me as a gay man, as a white gay man living in urban America, to mm-hmm. really support white gay men living in urban America. But that's really not where it's at.
Yeah.
Especially in 2016.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the foundation is about that. It's about spreading things around. When I write books, it's because if I don't write, I would go insane and die.
You have what, 5 books now?
Yes, five that are published, and I've written 8, but some of them are just terrible, or they just, I'm not going to lie, or they just haven't found their
home.
Those
are the bathroom books?
They haven't found their
bathroom
home. Books, like
they're in my bathroom, not in yours. They'd be in your bathroom book for other purposes, like, yeah. Oh, like this, it'll make it not smell bad.
What do you write about?
Whatever comes to mind. Mm. Goodness gracious.
Fiction?
Real? It's fiction, yes. No, I write novels. I'm a novelist.
Yes.
First 3 books I wrote were a bit of a trilogy, sort of Sex in the City meets Tales of the City mm-hmm. In West Hollywood, California. And then I wrote a historical novel from a feminist voice, first person, talking about colonialism in Congo and Central Africa in the mm-hmm. 1950s. Whoosh! And then I went over here and did a book talking about the relationship strain and family strife surrounding addiction and chemical dependency.
Yeah.
And so God knows what I'll write next.
So speaking
yes, sir.
Of what's next
yes, sir.
In Ben's life, what's next? What's the next chapter of your life? What do you want to accomplish that you haven't
know what?
Yet?
I've had a life which for quite a number of years has expanded and expanded and expanded and expanded. It got too big. So I've been in this sort of suspended phase for a little bit, and now I'm going to radically contract my life. I actually have sold my house. Hmm. I'm going to get an apartment in Hollywood.
I thought you were going to get one of those mini.
Yes,
mini
and then I'm going to drive
homes.
Around
a tiny
in
house.
A mini,
a
and I'm going
house.
To live in a
little tiny
little
house.
Cactuses, yeah. And I'm
you're
going,
too
no.
tall for a tiny
no,
house.
I
would worry
right.
about your.
I have ketosis as it is.
You can't.
Stoop. No, so I'm getting my life smaller, and
yeah.
I'm so looking forward to this. Because it'll allow me to just not worry about so damn many things. Mm-hmm. You know, again, having a big house sounds wonderful until you're constantly worried about the gutter and the this and the that. And
mm-hmm.
the, oh, and that, I've forgotten yeah. the termite thing, and they got to call that person about the, and that lady from the city with the inspection
right,
thing on the
right.
dripping. Oh my
yeah,
God, she won't leave me
alone.
All kinds
of stuff.
And
yeah.
that becomes your
low
life.
Low maintenance turnkey, it's good.
I'm telling
it's
you. Good. So I'm looking at that, or maybe I'm just going to check in somewhere. No, can you
if you like
service?
Cats, you can stay with
Motel
us.
Motel 6.
That'd be wonderful, wonderful.
Ben's going to live
there
at Motel
6 by you, and I'm going to live at the Motel 6.
Lovely. There's many lovely.
Oh, no, actually, though, I was at one of the places I'm looking at new apartments, and there's some beautiful, really
in the valley. You move into the valley, man.
No, I'm not moving. But looking
in
Hollywood, Hollywood. Actually,
we could have brunch, man.
Stuff. We could still have a lot of brunch in Hollywood.
Okay.
You could come
all
over.
Right.
Okay.
But
so
you know,
fancy.
It's like you're proximate to important things. Like there's one place that I'm looking at where it's, I would be across the street from Target.
Oh.
Okay. And McDonald's is next door.
Oh.
Is that good or bad? I mean, do you have
the answer is yes to that question?
Now, see, this is good. Not to sort of, I did not think that Target and McDonald's would come out of your mouth as, I just didn't expect that.
Where
that
do other people shop? I don't know.
McDonald's, really? What
well,
do you
not so
McDonald's?
Much McDonald's, but it's there. It's there. Yeah. If it's 2 a.m. and you need French fries, you can almost just kind of like
I love
reach
this guy.
And
oh
get
my
them.
God. What
I do
a
like
character.
A good fry. True. Completely not a good segue, but how do you define success?
Well, I'll tell you. Dollars. Just dollars. Nothing. No. I define success. Success and happiness, really. Okay. I mean, isn't that what the ultimate goal?
Yeah.
To absolutely. Feel happiness. Well, actually, I for the longest time thought that the goal of living was happiness. I may be kind of changing that a little bit. I'm going to turn 50 before terribly long, mm-hmm. terribly long. And you know, sort of this midlife thing. I think more so than even being happy, feeling, and I don't have the right word for it. It's not useful. That's not the word. Vital. Mm-hmm. Plugged in, alive, vibrant. Because that almost inevitably results in happiness.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, when you are plugged in, when you are in, to use a hackneyed term, the zone,
Right.
How can you be anything but happy? There's no room for anything else.
Yeah.
So when you are connected with your children, when you're connected with your family, when you're connected with your work, when you are passionate, and it doesn't necessarily mean that you're number one on the list of whatever, or that you're the wealthiest, or that you're the parent in the preschool who has the biggest SUV as you drop the kids off, or who takes on the most obligations in the 12-step meeting. But it's when you feel that you are doing your best.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And there's some level of service.
Yes.
Without.
Yes, inevitably.
Yeah.
Inevitably, and people. There is selflessness to service, but it's people don't understand how extraordinarily it benefits the person who is being of service.
Right.
And sometimes more than it does the alleged
beneficiary,
the supposed benefit.
Yes. Yeah. Well, because oftentimes service is done with "I'm doing this for you,"
but
I'm waiting for the payback. It's like really, truly, service is just you
one
give.
One thing I can tell about you, just from sitting here, and I'm sure that everybody out there can too. Every single person out there is going to relate with what I'm going to say right now. And that's that you have so much frickin' passion, man, in every ounce of your body.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what it is that you're talking about, the passion is just like, bam!
You see me grinning right now because that is just so, that's profoundly true, yes.
Yes.
I live life large and out loud.
Yeah, you do,
I live large in the sense of like too many complicated, but... Right. You know, like that. And I don't, I mean, I annoy, I text my friends and just text them and it's, and I'm just, my brain doesn't stop and my heart doesn't stop and my passion doesn't stop. And when I work with fellow activists and so forth, we just get all worked up because. Yeah.
Listen, you don't know how many Tuesdays you have.
Absolutely.
So it's like, you better make them
amazing. And one thing that I can say is that all the stuff that you've done in your past that you may not be so proud of have made you the awesome man that you are
today.
That
is absolutely true.
Absolutely, dude.
We are not.
So.
We're not just defined by the things that are.
Well, we are not all defined by our successes. Yeah. Our successes do not define us. It is our failures that which inform us and make us better human beings.
Yeah. Absolutely. You keep getting up.
That's what makes us who
absolutely.
We are.
Keep getting up. That's
for sure.
The key.
And we definitely have to do brunch.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's going
to
happen.
I'm in
we'll come
Hollywood.
To you.
on my side of the hill.
Hey, let's put Ben on the spot real quick and ask him one of those
questions.
Oh my
questions. God. Okay.
And then we'll get out of here.
The question no one knows. Just pick a card, darling.
This could be bad.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What's it say?
Read it like in your promo voice.
Okay. Am I being paid?
No. Mm-hmm.
If you could have any view from your back porch, what would it be? Any view?
Yes.
I would be a kid again, and I would watch my dad working on the car.
That's really sweet. You're gonna bring a tear to my eye, dude. You're like this big, tough sweetheart.
Thank you.
So cool, man. I am so, like I told you before, I'm a huge fan. Now I'm like a tremendous fan, right? Like the biggest fan you have. And so is Stacey.
Brilliant talent. You're a beautiful human being.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much for being here. We had such a great time.
And thank you for your patience.
Absolutely.
These people, they're being so kind to me. But I literally had to.
Everybody gets here when it's right. This is the right time for you to be here. You weren't supposed to be here this summer.
Yeah. I
love it.
Thank you so much.
You're so welcome here. We love you. And
could I come back sometime?
Absolutely.
Yeah, you can come back anytime, dude.
There's another chair. You just come every time.
Now bring my dog.
Chelsea.
She remembered
what's your dog's
the name. She remembered the name I gave the throw pillow.
You're very good.
That's
you're
a good host.
Yeah, that is a good host. Right on, man.
Thank you for having me.
So cool.
Ben Patrick Johnson. Find him on Twitter, you guys. BenPatrick90069.
Anywhere. Social media.
Yes.
Absolutely. Yeah. And we will see you guys next time.
Hey, everybody.
Hey, this is Ben Patrick Johnson. I just got buzzed with Chuck and Stacey. And remember, wherever you go, be authentic.
Well, that concludes our two-part interview with the iconic Ben Patrick Johnson. Ooh, wow!
Amazing, this man.
I've been a huge fan of Ben's for years, man. Yeah. I'm so glad we've had this time to talk to him.
Such a cool guy.
Absolutely.
Remember to keep up with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. It's right there. Click it. We love you guys. Thank you so much for watching. And just remember, you always have time for a little buzz.
Buzz Weekly is sponsored by Chuck Duran's Demos That Rock. The voiceover demo producer to the stars is now available to you. Visit demosthatrock.com and take your voiceover career to the next level.
See you next time. And remember, you always have time for a little buzz.